should be.
We have an understanding.
Both jobs.
Hey, guys.
How do you guys feel about votes of no confidence in people who haven't been here ever?
Yeah.
Tonight?
Yeah.
Like tonight at the end of the.
So you're thinking most of the attitude to add a. Yeah, I'm thinking about that.
I think I'll give a little one more.
We have more minutes. Because both of you have just went to the office. Actually, I told the next team and tell them that we have more if he comes back. We're gonna go ahead and call the order at 6:44 p.m. Is this font size decent for you?
In point of personal privilege, Peter.
Yes.
You have it the 13th for the roster.
Oh, you get over here, right? That's just the file. I'm not really sure. Okay.
Also said that in Google.
Oh, my bad. Are there any people who would like to speak during public comment? Seeing none, we will move into attendance. Abraham! Ali?
Here.
Apia? Audubon? Baruka? Bernardin?
Here.
Bonaventura?
There.
Burns. Carol. Caruso. Chen.
Here.
Contreras.
Here.
Carolla. Crow.
Yep.
J. Crow. B. Crow.
Here.
Demura.
Here.
Duncan. Edwards. Ephraimov. Fazina.
Here.
Gomez. Hagen. Harvey. Hinton. Jane. Javari.
Here.
Kelly. Kleisen.
Oh, wait.
Kleisen. Kundu.
Here.
McCarthy. McHugh.
Here.
McManus.
Here.
Nima. Murray.
Here.
Guauca. Mm-hmm. I learned his name. Reynolds.
Here.
Rogalski. Sinopola.
Here.
Schroeder.
Present.
Seifert or Cypher. Teeling. Thacker.
Here.
Tiberio.
Here.
Boring. Walker. Rotina.
Yeah.
Brett.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. You didn't count in your own.
How did you make that?
Just stands up there. Hey guys, so while we're waiting for Parliament, I just have two things really quick.
quick. I know most of you are in the grouping, but for those of you who aren't in the Senate grouping, one of these lovely people will allow you guys to get in. And then second of all, I only got, like, I think 22 of you for the headshots, like, that have been sent out. But if you didn't get a headshot, or if you haven't chosen yours yet, please let me know. Send me a text, and I'll make sure that you guys get your headshots. I've sent them to, like, pretty much everybody, but I just have a bunch of people that haven't picked those yet. So let me know how I need a chance. Thanks.
If three is quorum, then it's floor.
Yeah. Okay. I'm floor.
Fantastic.
It appears that we now have a quorum. We will move into the Senate agenda. There are no prior minutes to approve from this semester. We have a pending this semester. We'll move into the report of programs. Is there a report for programs? Do you have a report?
I don't have a report, but I think for it.
No. We'll move into the report of the student development chair. You want it?
So we have I feel like we have a pretty straightforward semester for student development. We're mainly working on spring weekend events. There's a ton of like logistics behind that, so there's a lot of work going into planning with the cultural centers, planning our Founders Day, planning our like cake. So it's keeping us really busy, but that's really large what we're working on. There's some old business stuff that I would like to work on. Last semester we talked about consent posters. I would like to see that happen this semester. Also, there's a few things that when I met with the Rainbow Center director that I feel like USG, specifically student development, can help the Rainbow Center with. So I'd like to introduce those to my committee, see what they think about them. And that's it.
Are there any questions for the chairperson?
Yeah.
April 19th. Are there any further questions?
I yield.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, we'll move to the report of the Academic Affairs Chair. Oh, right. My bad. Student Services Chair.
Not too far.
So we've been pretty busy. First off, tampon time, we reached out on Facebook on Buy or Sell, and we were able to get a little over 90 responses in less than a week, which was improvement from last semester. And what we did is that we were able to come up with a comprehensive schedule for the remainder of the month. And with those people, we're having orientation with them starting next week to show them where the supplies are, introduce them to Don and Daria, show them where to put the supplies and so on. We're also going to be opening up the orientation to the rest of the committee so that the rest of the volunteers, because the process for choosing the volunteers for each week is really random because you can't have all 90 people go to this, but only a specific number of dispensers. So starting hopefully in the next 2 weeks, we're going to get more people besides myself and Katie to show it the new volunteers where to get the supplies and so on. And that's been really well. We had Pam, who's the director of Red Light, come to our meeting yesterday. And she really broke down the incident with the pronouns down for us. And even though, even though her reasoning didn't necessarily, we talked about how we're going to remedy the situation, even if the foundation isn't necessarily something that wants faith either. So we're going to be working with RHA, with speakers, Circle, for allowing students to have their pronouns if they would like. And we're going to have some representatives go to RHA's meetings every Friday now at 4 p.m. if anyone else is interested in increasing collaboration and activity with RHA, you're welcome to go to. Just let me know and I can text Brittany and let them know that you're coming. Compliance fee, she's really great with working with the other students who are interested in making this an issue to bring about to global affairs, and there's been a lot of progress. She probably speaks to it better than I can, but every single week we're all amazed by the progress, and you told me this morning, right? So they calculated all the ISS numbers for comparing other universities, and they're going to be taking that over to global affairs and trying to remedy the situation. Financial literacy, we're planning an event with financial aid bursars. Our current person was unable to show a presentation that she made on exactly how she wants that event to go since our talks with Pam do last longer than we expected, so next week that's what we're going to be talking about. Sustainability Subcommittee has submitted 2 proposals to Matt and Leah, and if we get approved for those events, which one is an art panel and 2 is an environmental justice event that bridges together climate justice and climate policy and gender. And if we do get approved by Matt and Leah, the Matt and Leah Committee will actually fund all that, so the money from that will be coming from student services. And that's going pretty well. The panelists are all finalized, and the room reservations for the art exhibit is finalized as well. And we are going to be working, we now have 2 student services members that go to the Suicide Prevention Committee meetings every couple of weeks, and I think we're going to be collaborating with Active Minds later on this year on an event to bring awareness to mental health issues on campus and show that you should care about those things.
Are there any questions for the chairperson? One from Senator Rolo.
Do you feel like the ResLife director's account of what happened was truthful and accurate? Or was there anyone there really to, like, I don't see fact checker, but make sure what you're saying was what actually happened.
So, I mean, you ask me as a person, as a
as a community chairperson, that's your best.
I will say personally, I think I talked to a lot of RAs and people that were on the front line of this issue, and I think she didn't go over accountability in the way that I would personally wanted to, but I was really impressed and happy about her wanting to take steps towards remedying the situation, ensuring that something like this doesn't happen again, and that students are able to have their opinions and voices heard in decisions like that. So,
okay. Thank you. Are there any further questions? Senator Baruch.
Where and when are the RHA meetings?
The RHA meetings are at the RHA headquarters and towers. It's on the same side as the dining hall. That's about all I know. I don't know what building it is exactly. I haven't gone yet, but it is on floor at 4 p.m.
Point of information. Are you familiar with where the game room for towers is?
I am.
It's on the other side of that building. There's a door, and that door is to the RHA. Are there any further questions for the chairperson? Seeing none, we'll move into the report of the Academic Affairs Chair. Chairperson Gatherer, I believe you have that report.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm so sorry I was not able to attend tonight, especially with the recent Senate cancellation. I truly hope you're all having a great semester, and I hope to see you all soon. Academic Affairs has had a productive few weeks so far. Last week, the University Director of Advising, Trina Higgins, stopped by to briefly discuss the results of the advising survey sent out last semester. The majority of the students who filled it out were first and second year students, but a few third year students as well. 80% of students said that they were slightly, moderately, or extremely satisfied with the program, which is good news because it means that the system is not broken. More details will be released in regards to that as we evolve deeper into the survey results. The committee has also been working on the first panel event of the semester, Keep the Cap on Track. It will be an event for students to have a chance to directly interact with distinguished faculty, including the Director of Undergraduate Research, University Director of Advising, Dean of Honors Program, and hopefully the Interim Provost. Students will be allowed to voice their academic questions and concerns, which will help our committee as well as our invited guests get an understanding on what initiatives to focus on next. The event will take place on March 5th, with more details to come soon. We will also begin work on the Undergraduate Research EX3's project once our proposed budget is approved. If you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to email me. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll now move into the report of the funding board chair, which I will read. Hello all. I hope that everybody's semester is going well. Unfortunately, I will not be able to attend Senate this semester. Because of this, I encourage anybody with questions regarding funding matters to reach out to me at fundingboard@usg.ucon.edu. As for my report, funding is proceeding as normal for this week. We have recently announced the deadline for the spring 2018 funding, which will be on March 9th at 11:59 a.m. For every president's work, for any president's or treasurer's of tier two groups, I urge you to begin working on requests ahead of that time. The funding system will close on that deadline, meaning any incomplete requests will automatically be not funded. The date for when the funding system will open again for the fall 2018 semester is currently tentative. An internal review of the funding board committee will also be recurring over the weekend. It is possible after this review that a few seats on the committee will open up. In order to account for this, I intend on sending out an email, which at the time of this may already have been sent out, to send regarding letters of intent to join the funding board. I encourage anybody who is interested to please apply. As always, please feel free to reach out to me regarding any funding board related topics. Best, Richard Perry. Next, we'll move into the report of the External Affairs Chair.
Hi guys, it's nice to see you all back here for this semester. So in External Affairs, right now, at least at the town level, me and Andrew Rogowski attended the University Town Relations meeting the other day. And they basically focused a lot on discussing planning for spring weekend and warmer weather and dealing with that and relating to the relationship with the university and the town. They also spoke on the new hockey arena that is being planned. It will probably be near Freitas and probably not on the old place they were planning on Discovery Drive. And that is what's going on at the town level. Right now, also, there's going to be a forum with planning and zoning from Mansfield, members of that, on probably February 27th, we're planning that. We'll reach out with more information on when that will be and where that will be, but that will be happening February 27th. At the state level, we approved the funding for buses to go to the appropriations hearing, which is this Thursday. I know you all have probably received emails from Irma regarding the trip. It's not too late to go on the trip. The buses leave at 3:30 and return around 8:45. We'd love to have as many people as we can get, although we're being mostly spared, at least this year, with budget cuts. It would be great to have the university, and we're committed to the state and that our students are committed to the future of the university. Also at the state level, where me and Michael Port and Josh and Owen are working on a project to have a gubernatorial forum of all the governor candidates, probably in early April. We are still deciding on a site for that. We're going to speak with Gail Garber, Susan Herbst, to try to see if we can get Jorgensen here. If not, we probably have something in the union. So we'll have more updates on that, but that will probably be in early April. And the last thing is, for the legislative reception, we will be having that March 28th from 6:30 to 8:30 in the Union Ballroom, in place of, I believe, caucus. We reached out, Steve has been helping with that. We reached out to legislators, the Mansfield Town Council, and political science professors to invite them to that as a way of networking and team building for that. So we'll have more on that, but that's March 28th. And that is all right now for us.
Thank you. We'll move to the report of Jesus Jonathan Colbert.
Hi everyone. Unfortunately, Kyle can't attend the Senate this semester, but if you have any questions or concerns, you can email him at vpchiefstaff@usg.uconn.edu. So going to his report, thank you to everyone who has shared the appropriations event. And in the future, please share events when he posts them on Facebook so that we can reach the most students possible. Also, the post he put in Firesville yesterday, please tag your friends and like it so that it keeps going up higher and people can see it. And also fill out the survey if you haven't. He's also working with the University Communications Office to help feature candidates for the elections on their social media, mostly Snapchat. He's just waiting on George to have the final list of candidates so that can all be finalized. Banquet planning is going great, and we'll have a DJ and buzz quotes by this week.
Thank you. We'll now move into the report of the Chief Justice. Seeing that, we'll move into the report of the Speaker. So as you know, our past two regularly scheduled Senates have been canceled due to weather. The first one, both due to actually university delays and snow days, which is both great for us and horrible for us. And is the reason we had to have this meeting, because we are constitutionally required to have one meeting every 2 weeks of the academic semester. We got away the first time because the first week of school was a full week, but now we have to meet. One thing that I've been working on is governing documents review. The ad hoc or the Senate subcommittee has stopped meeting in favor of combining the two committees under the ad hoc umbrella to foster cooperation and harmony in working towards a new constitution and bylaws. Other than that, I haven't received any legislation so far. Please do so. Please, if you have any initiatives, send them through committees and then, of course, bring them to Senate. I received all your emails with your initiatives that you were working on this semester, and I can't wait to see that come to fruition. I will not be running for the speakership for next year, so the position, there will be no incumbent for this role next year, next session. With that in mind, I want to make sure that there is a smooth transition. So if you do intend to run for the speakership, please let me know so that I can help you work towards understanding what the role is and details. That's all for me. Are there any questions? Senator Bruno.
Is Tom the Terry of the Cisco?
Yes. Senator Bruno. Order. Oops. Why is there laughter? There should not be laughter. Senator Wilkinson.
So you didn't raise your hand first.
Oh.
No, I didn't raise my hand first. Were there any resignations?
Yes. I have received the resignation of Senator Seifert and Senator Raja Raman. They have class conflicts this semester and will not be able to attend. Senator Murray.
As Senator Seifert was the deputy speaker, do you intend on replacing him moving forward?
Potentially. Yes, I do. I will solicit applications and move forward with that process as soon as I can. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, we'll move to the report of the comptroller.
Hi, everyone. So, President Valverde and I finished our SBAC presentation to represent our budget and our 2-year projections to the advisory committee. It went really well. This Senate, I'll be presenting our spring budget, so I met with committee chairs this past week. So, this is a thing. Other than that, I think we'll start reviewing our inventory system and then possibly looking at policies first with our staff and then inviting USU members to help with the policies.
Are there any questions for the comptroller? Senator Bruco.
Since one of the, we made the subcommittee for the governing docs last semester, one of its roles was also to look at the funding policies. Since it's been absorbed by the ad hoc, I just wanted to know.
A point of information.
Yes.
Only the subcommittee for governing documents, only the subcommittee for governing documents has been removed or shelved. The other subcommittee is still alive.
Okay, with the funding policies?
Does that answer your question?
Yep.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, we'll move into the report of the Vice President.
So I just want to start off by we've been having some reoccurring issues in our office space with our staff. So I just want to touch base with everyone and have a little conversation. And then also just go over the role of our staff. I know there were some questions at caucus about what exactly they do and how they provide support to our organization. So we have four full-time staff members, Dawn, Daria, Nikki, and Lindsay. We are very lucky to have them. They are really amazing, and many of them have worked with this organization for many years, and without them, we would be unable to provide students with the amount and the caliber of funding that we do. Since we are students, we do need people in the staff at all hours in order to assist students and answer your questions. If you're ever in the office, feel free to introduce yourself to them. They love working with us, and they're always excited to meet new members of the organization. And also, you can refer students who have questions when they come into the office to any of the bookkeepers. If, say, Lindsay's not at her desk, you can send them back to Dawn, Daria, or Nikki, or even our student bookkeepers. And then we also have, in addition to our full-time staff, we have our student bookkeeping staff and SOC workers. So the student bookkeeping staff, they assist the full-time bookkeepers and by setting up purchase orders and preparing requests for the organization, those tier two organizations can be funded. And then our SOC workers, they oversee the SOC space, assist student groups coming in, getting copies, and they also take minutes for all of our committees, which we greatly appreciate. And if you're ever in the office space or even the SOC, feel free to say hi, introduce yourself to them. And with that being said, I just want to go over a few other things. So when we're sending emails to our staff, we want to make sure they're professional, that if we need something for them, it's always better to pose it in a question format and to make declarative statements. They're always so willing to help us whenever they can. So just shoot them a really nice, polite email. Also, just when some tone is really important, so just make sure that we're being, you know, extremely polite, nice to them. Again, we want to treat them the best way possible just because we don't want to lose them. We've been very lucky that they stayed with us for many years, and if we lost them, it would also be a disadvantage to not only our organization, but also to the students who we provide funding for, because they are so knowledgeable and it's so much information. Also, just be aware when conversations are taking place in the office, just be aware of the tone, language, and volume that you're using. We just want to remember that this is a workplace. People are trying to get things done, and it can be very distracting to them, especially when the noise level gets really loud. So just try to be aware of that. You know, after hours, when the door is shut, you know, you can be as loud as you want to, but just try to be really mindful of that until 4:30. Also, just, I know sometimes, you know, we can have certain conversations about controversial topics, and it can sometimes get heated. I'm not saying that we shouldn't be having these conversations, but we just want to also be aware that it is a workplace and it can be distracting for the workers, and we also want to be creating a welcoming environment. You know, we have a lot of students coming in and out of our office who don't know us personally, and they might walk in, hear someone having a really heated argument, and might be kind of put off by that and not feel comfortable, especially if they personally possess a different viewpoint. So we want to just make sure we're maintaining that professionalism. And, you know, if you really want to have that conversation right then, you can always, like, pop into the SOC conference room and shut the door if no one else is using that. That way we're not distracting our workers, and that's going to be placed in office space. And also, just keep it clean. Please don't take items. And thank you to whoever returned the clock. It is back, by the way. But, you know, we do pay for the things, everything in our office with student fee money. So when you take something, that means you have to buy it again, and we don't want to be wasting students' money. Also, if you're in the office space after hours, please, please, please make sure you shut the door when you leave, especially if you are the last one in the office. There's been a few incidents where the next morning the door is wide open, and we just have a lot of stuff in there. We don't want someone coming in after, taking something, so just be cognizant of that. Also, if you ever need minutes, just send an email to supervisor@usg.uconn.edu at least 1 week in advance, and if you need to book a conference room, email info@usg.uconn.edu or fill out the online form. Again, this is just really, you know, this has just been, wanted to quickly just like touch our base about this so we can all have like a super successful semester and keep using our office space, because it's so great and such a privilege that we're able to go in there during the day, do work, print, and all that stuff. So, on a lighter note, some other stuff I've been working on, senior souls, if you are graduating after the semester, please fill out the form by Friday. I'm going to look into placing the order over the weekend. I already have some quotes, which is great. I've also talked to Owen, who's awesome, about doing a senior photo shoot for all of our amazing seniors. So I'll let you guys know more about that once you have the details worked out. Banquet is also going to be March 31st from 7 to 11. It's Saturday. It's at Las Vegas Country Club. It's really nice there. They have really good food too, so we'll be leaving campus around 6 p.m. You can also bring a date with you. I'm meeting with Kimberly Miller tomorrow morning just to talk about, you know, pricing, everything like that, get all the details worked out, and then so I'll probably be signing up cars with you tomorrow. We're also having an SOC staff meeting on Monday, super excited for that. And if you, that's it for me. If you guys have any questions or concerns, feel free to ask. Sorry, that's kind of a lot.
Are there any questions for the vice or for the report from the vice president? Seeing none, we'll move to the report of the president.
Okay, I have this one as well. Sorry. Okay, so this is from Irma. She wrote this, we're just going to read it. Hi, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day. I apologize I could not be here tonight. I had this listed as a caucus for some time now, and so I had another commitment already. But glad that we got to have a special Senate so everyone can come together. It has been some time now since we have last spoken, so I apologize if you cannot recall everything. It has been a busy few weeks, but of course, if I miss something or if you have any questions about anything, please reach out to me. VP update. So as I mentioned earlier in the semester, VP Johnson resigned due to personal reasons. I took some time to think of the next steps, and I'm glad that Gabby was willing to take on this role for the next few weeks. With Gabby no longer being student development, though, that left the vacancy, Buckery Zachary Cola submitted the letter of intent, and I thought he would be a perfect chair moving forward. Tonight they will be up for confirmation, and I will be giving a brief explanation for both people. Parking. The Transportation Committee is starting to meet in March, so Kyle developed a survey that we sent out to students to hear their feedback and comments on the current parking situation. Myself, Stern, and other USG members will be active with this to ensure we can see some positive changes. Appropriations. Appropriations here tomorrow. Please consider going if you haven't signed up. If you did, though, please make sure to wear UConn apparel and show up on time. All the details are on the email. SBAC presentation. Comptroller Scott and I presented in front of the Student Fee Advisory Committee. It went extremely well. I just want to thank her as for all her hard work on this as well. As Comptroller Tadani probably mentioned, we'll be reviewing the policies to make some quick changes to help the staff and students. These won't be controversial, but rather just seeing what issues there have been and how to prevent it in the future. Funding Board. Calls for letter of intent. We would like to see if anyone is interested in applying to increase the amount of requests being reviewed. If you have questions or concerns, contact myself or Richard. Changes. After speaking with our financial advisor and the professional staff, we realize that the best decision for funding moving forward is it for not to be a standing committee and to be student jobs. The outline of this will be prepared and presented to Senate, as well as the explanation for it. There are two reasons that a position is created, which includes that it's hard to find someone to move the position and accountability. Professional staff stated that this would change funding in the best way possible. Constitution. As everyone should know by now, the Governing Doc Subcommittee was disbanded, so we have all been working together as the ad hoc. We are meeting one last time on Monday night, but we'll be presenting all the changes to Senate next Wednesday. Thank you to everyone who took the time to be involved with this, and I look forward to presenting the ideas to you all. University Senate, two seats for University Senate are open, and we are available Mondays 4 to 6, and are interested, just reach out to me. I'll send out calls as well.
She has.
If you have any questions, just reject her.
Senator Murray?
Sure. I mean, I'm sure you're not already able to reject this, but I was just hoping that you could convey a term. I was just wondering if, since Kyle was splitting his time between Chief of Staff and PR Director, and since Marissa is abroad, if you would know if Irma is going to be adding another Chief of Staff in the semester?
So, Irma is not going to be taking another Chief of Staff just because she doesn't really have any work to give to someone. Everything that she's been working on, she has under control. And also, Kyle and I have like just been kind of splitting up the VP stuff, and then we also do all of our social media stuff as well. But she doesn't see that there is a need right now. But if anything does change, I'm sure she will share that with all of you.
Sure, thank you.
Are there... I'd like to motion to add back the report of the speaker as an end of the report section by unanimous consent. Are there any objections? Seeing none, I just want to take this opportunity to drive home the stuff that was in the vice president's report about office conduct and office etiquette. It is important that we treat our staff, both student and professional, with respect. Keep in mind that that is an actual workplace. People, Don, Daria, and Nikki, and Lindsay work there 9-to-5, and it's important that you treat it like you would somewhere where you would work 9-to-5. It is, frankly, unacceptable the type of experiences that not only professional staff but student staff have been having with some of our colleagues and with students in general. We need to make sure we take steps to ensure that that is an environment that is professional. I don't want to beat ahead a dead horse, so I'll yield at that. Seeing no items in old business, we'll move to new business. I'd like to switch item B to item A by unanimous consent. Are there any objections? I'd also like to add an item C. If you look in the drive, an act concerning the spring 2018 budget to the agenda. Do we have any objections for that? Okay. Seeing no objections, we will move into what was previously item B, the nomination of Gabrielle Fazina to the vice presidency of the student body. I'd like to kick off discussion with two prepared statements. Yes. Oh, that's true. Can we have a motion? Who's first? I think Reynolds was first and Pro was second. So motion goes to Reynolds, second goes to B, Pro. This is from the president. Good evening. I'm so sorry I couldn't be in attendance tonight, but I had made a prior commitment when I thought this was a caucus. Due to VP Johnson's resignation, I had to select a new vice president. I selected Gabrielle for the role because of her 3 years of experience in the organization, her dedication to USG, and the work ethic. When selecting someone for this role, I also wanted to select someone who was a current senior and graduating in order to not give someone a springboard. Although Gabby will be graduating after the semester, I know she will be fully committed to the role for the rest of her term. Gabby and I have always worked extremely well together and have a close relationship. I have always trusted her and confided in her. Even though she has not been officially sworn in yet, Gabby has assumed the roles of vice president while also helping Zach oversee the Student Development Committee and transition into his new role. She has already booked our spring banquet, worked on membership events, and scheduled an SOC staff meeting. She has a great understanding of how the organization functions and has a close relationship with our staff. I have no doubt in my mind that she will be great in this role, and I'm excited to continue working alongside her for the remainder of the semester. Next, I have a comment to read from VP Chief of Staff Goncalves. Senators, I regretfully could not be here with you tonight to speak on the behalf of my friend Gabrielle Fazina, whom I hope you will confirm as our vice president this evening. For as long as I've known Gabby, she has been fearlessly committed to USG, its members, its mission, and the work our organization does to help better the student experience here at UConn. Throughout this year that I have spent on exec with Gabby, I have witnessed firsthand her enthusiasm for our organization, her willingness to always be among one of the first exec members to volunteer for anything that is ever needed, and her leadership as the chair of student development. It is without a shadow of a doubt that I can say Gabby is more than qualified for this position. But in the interest of time, I won't spend much time dissecting her qualifications here, and will rather focus on a different point that should not be overlooked. As of this semester, I am the only member on the cabinet, and when the year started back in August, there were three of us, which leaves me with a lot of ground to make up. Thankfully, my relationship with Gabby is one that enjoys constant open communication and, above all, trust. Gabby and I have worked together extremely well in the past in her role as student development chair. And since the resignation of VP Johnson, Gabby and I have been working on a variety of projects that I could not have gone through without her leadership and guidance. Gabby could have waited until she was officially confirmed to step into this role, but upon being nominated by President Valverde, Gabby stepped up on her own accord and has taken on two roles simultaneously. Her organization skills are impeccable, and I'm certain that Gabby has everything that it takes to excel in this position for the remainder months of this semester. Should you need any additional information on this matter, please reach out to me. Is there any further discussion on this item? Senator Quirrell.
So as President Valverde said, Gabby has not only been fulfilling VP duties, but she's been helping me so much with transitioning into committee chair for student development. I just like to say, greatly appreciate it. She's so professional. She does a ton of work, timely, amazingly, outstandingly. She's awesome. I've had her as a committee chair all last semester, and I'm really happy that she was able to do it. So I hope you also share my enthusiasm.
Thank you, Senator Grohl. Yes, I've been talking to you. Is there any further discussion? Senator Corbin. Yes, Senator Bondinger.
I just want to say that last year, at the end of the year, I had the pleasure of working with Gabby on Spring Weekend. And I just want to say that I don't know if you'll find a hardworking, more dedicated person to this organization. And I know, she's already received a lot of praise, but trust me, every word that what people said is completely accurate and valid, and I really don't know if there's anyone else that could do as good a job in this position than her, and she could, so definitely give her your nomination because you'll be very happy.
Thank you, Senator Bondinger. Is there any further discussion? Go ahead. Thank you, Senator. Are there any further comments? Seeing none, we will move into a vote. All those in favor of the nomination of Gabrielle Fazina to the Vice Presidency of the student body, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please signify by saying nay. Any abstentions? One motion. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have been confirmed. The next item on the agenda is the nomination of Zachary Corolla to the Student Development Chair. Do we have a motion? Motion goes to Baruga. Second goes to Bernardo. You get a lot of seconds. Is there any discussion on this item? Senator Berger.
Can I start by asking a question, Speaker? What grade are you in, Mr. Grover?
A senior.
And so Zachary here is a senior and is choosing to spend his last couple semesters taking on a role of a very high maintenance, very organized position. And I feel like no one else is qualified to lead student development other than Zachary Corolla. His issues that he points out and the matters that he wants to take on benefit the student body more than anybody I've ever seen. And I frankly think he's one of the best qualified candidates for this position just in the short time he's been in USG. He's constantly active, he's constantly vocal in Senate meetings, and he really, really is trying to find the best ways to serve all cultures and experiences on this campus. So I think if you want somebody that's dedicated to the culture of UConn, want to progress student efforts in all, from any minority group, any ethnicity, any identity, I feel like Corolla is your man. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator Baruga. Remember, snaps are not. You can't do snaps. Thank you, Senator. Is there any discussion? I'm going to recognize Vice President.
Hi, everyone. So I've had the pleasure of observing Corbin and Zachary since he joined student development at the beginning of last semester. And he has been extremely committed and involved in all that the committee has done so far. During our meetings, Zach always engages with other members, and he offers up great ideas all the time. During the fall at NYU, Zachary also put a lot of effort and thought into planning all the events that we did have that day. We had three events that day, and Zachary was at all of them, which I greatly appreciate. That's awesome. Also, I believe Zach will be an amazing chair, and I'm excited to see it all that he and the committee will accomplish this semester. I have been meeting with him and transitioning, and I believe that he is fully ready and capable to take over this role. And Zachary is also one of the most passionate people that I know, and he has
foster such great leadership and ideas, so I'm really excited to see him lead this committee for the rest of the semester. So he, if I could vote, I'd be voting for him, and I think that you all should too as well. And I also have something from our budget.
Is there any further discussion? Seeing discussion from President Liberty.
This is from Irma. Zachary Corolla has been an extremely passionate member since the minute he joined USG. With student development, you need a chair who cares about diversity, but also about the university deeply in order to work on traditions. Zachary has also been a dedicated member of student development, so I know that he will lead the committee in the right direction and fulfill his responsibilities. It was also important for me to have someone who was a part of the committee so that it would not shift the dynamic of the committee or add a time to train him. Overall, Zach is the best person to chair this committee, and I'm excited to see what he will accomplish this semester.
Thank you. Is there any further discussion on this item? Go ahead. Thank you. Are there any further discussion? Senator Bogino.
So I fully support Zach's position. I would just like to ask him, pose a question, what are some goals, issues, or projects you have for us?
Senator Corolla.
So, like I said in my report, we're definitely working spring weekend. That's, I think, our main number one thing. As I said, we have three different events. We did three events for the fall anyway, and we're able to do it. I feel like our team has a really great practice with putting on a big university event like Metanoia, like Spring Weekend. So I'm very excited about that. We have Let Me Kate, Culture Center Open House, and Founders Day. As I said in the report, before even Gabby was chair, there were consent posters made, and we've been talking about it last semester. I would like to see that done. I think that's really important, especially on the college campus. Not exactly sure what that whole idea will look like. I have ideas, but I would have to talk to my committee. And then I met with the Rainbow Center director last semester, and I just have some things I'd like to work with the Rainbow Center on. I'll talk to my committee, see if they want to take those up, but I personally would like to pursue those kinds of issues in my role as a senator.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any further points of discussion? Senator Chen.
So, Jack was in the service community last semester, and I'm in the service community too, and he's very supportive and friendly and full of leadership. So, I think he will be a good position in this chair. Yeah, I
thank you. Are there any further points of discussion? Seeing none, we'll move into a vote. All in favor of the nomination of Zachary Corolla to the Student Development Chairperson, please signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, please signify by saying nay. Any abstentions? One from Senator Corolla and one from the Chair. In the opinion of the Chair, the ayes have it, the motion carries. Budget. Do we have a motion? The motion goes to Peruco, second goes to Crow. Is this visible then?
Yes.
Discussion on the side.
to go over this with you. So every semester, as council, one of my duties is to create a budget. And so the past weeks I've met with all the committee chairs, I've met so then trying to figure out what we should do for this semester. So as you can see, our total revenue is based solely on the number of people paying students, so it's a very conservative number. And then every semester we typically have a rollover. So whatever student fees we didn't use for the following semester, we just add that on. So that's those are the numbers you can see there. So to go through the breakdown, so student services, mainly their budget, is $8,000. Almost mainly going to is Student Appreciation Day. So the past years we've kind of, that has been like up to $10,000. This year we're trying to focus more on maybe advocacy, maybe, and also bringing in other departments to kind of talk about like what kind of services we offer at UConn. Tampon time, as normally expected, that's what we're spending every semester. And then at NOIA events, as Chairperson Gagarin said, this is just a budget version, but that NOIA committee might pay for it. For student development, the biggest events are Culture Center Open House. This year we're trying to cap price match Culture Center, so we get $500 from each Culture Center, and then they match us with that amount. Founders Day, which is typically a normal expense, and then we're going to draft us. And funding board, as you can see, so our budget is $800,000, which is a normal expense. So community outreach can fund up to $45,000 of their alterings, and that's just based on an agreement that we sign in the fall. Academic fairs, they're trying to have a panel event with the provost on distinguished faculty. So that would just include money for space rental, catering, care packages. We did that last semester. They were very successful, so we're doing it again. And the research opportunity video, which they're just partnering with the research department to create these videos. External affairs, normal expenses, they're spending about $6,100 on going to mostly the outreach events, which is the appropriations meeting tomorrow, the forum, and then the legislative launch. And then programs, again, the biggest expenses are New York Times, so every semester we spend about $18,000 to $20,000 on New York Times. Next year, we're trying to change that and move to more of a digitized version and partner with other departments on campus. SLC wages, those just all our staff, our bookkeepers, our budget takers, that's just normal expense. And the frequent data, we did that last semester, we're going to do that again, and we'll spend that much. The Harlan Coleman Speakers, as you know, programs had an event a few weeks ago, and that was just the expense from that. And UST general expenses, those include our wages for our four full-time staff, and then any like postage, office supplies, anything that goes towards funding. And I believe, and then Senate was just $2,000, and that just goes towards room rental and replacing plaques and things like that. So that is basically the budget. So that's pretty much it. Our expenses are less than obviously our revenue, so we did cut a lot internally this semester. So that's about it.
So, quick question about the programs budget. So, I see that you budgeted $18,000 for the New York Times staff. However, I've been hearing from my constituents that the New York Times newspaper has been consistently not there. So, do you know anything about that?
Yeah, so to kind of speak on that, so I guess because of there was a delay in payment last semester, the New York Times, I guess they decided not to like give us copies until that's sorted out. So, I think Chairperson is working on that. So that the number is expected. The number will be a lot lower this semester just because they haven't been receiving copies.
Sure.
But they should be getting that soon.
Okay. That was a thing.
Are there any further questions or are there any further points of discussion?
Is this available in the folder for Senate today?
Yes.
I just want to
for the student development budget, it's also for the Office of Diversity.
Yes, that's it. I have
not. No, I'm just saying it's just in the interest of being like fully detailed. That's
Which line item?
Oh, Culture Center Open House, yeah. Is that like a friendly amendment?
Yeah, do you want to make a friendly amendment to do that?
Yes.
Okay.
The six cultural centers plus the just something we look back in records, we can see that that's there. That's it.
friendly amendment was made. Are there any objections from the sponsors of this bill? The amendment is taken as friendly. I believe Senator Rotina has a friendly amendment as well.
Yeah. So it's very minor, but this is a risk factor. The line for Metanoia events is Metanoia is called correct. So just, you know.
Do we have a friendly amendment?
Yeah.
Yes.
Are there any objections from the sponsors of this bill? Seeing none, the amendment is taken as friendly. Are there any points, motions, or discussion items? Senator Burr.
I'm not going to waste our time. I mean, all the questions have been asked. The budget's going to be created. I just want to say, for what it's worth, that I have gotten a chance to go over this, and it seems very good. And I suck with numbers and that sort of thing. So I put my support behind Montrose County, and I encourage you all to vote yes.
Senator Baxter.
Is the rollover that you have on there the rollover from last semester?
Yeah.
And what is it predicted to be for this semester going into next semester?
I believe it's around like $115,000. But last semester for funding, we underspent, so we allocated $800,000. We probably spent around $650,000. So I expect the rollover for this semester to be around that number.
That's a rollover from last semester? No,
this is a rollover for the following semester.
Oh, okay.
If we spend this much.
If we spend that much, but
yeah.
So what I was asking is, if we don't spend this much, like how much do we typically spend on the spring?
I guess around like 900,000 to about, I mean, not even, I think I would say around like 800,000 is pretty much.
Okay, I'm just curious because on the SBAC, and then if you keep like what we dealt with these semesters ago with being in projected debt by 2019.
Yeah, no, so I think the way the deficit was, I guess that was just based on projections that we're in a pretty good place, basically.
Okay.
So I wouldn't worry too much about that.
Senator Lucino.
Was there a rollover going into fall 2017?
Fall 2017.
Oh.
So we're going into last
year.
Yeah,
that was about, if you want to listen to your budget, but,
It's in the minutes.
Yeah, but there was a rollover, and it was, like, pretty large, I would say. It was about, like, $600,000.
I have a discussion. So, we allocated roughly $1 million during the fall of 18. How much of that did we actually spend? Yeah, last
one. We don't know the exact numbers just because we're still processing funding requests. I guess I'd say for funding we probably spend right now it's $550,000, but we expect to have another $100,000 to be processed. And then most committees like Snowden didn't really spend anything. Academic affairs spent under budget. So I can get the numbers back for you, but
thank you. Are there any further points or motions on the floor? Any further items for discussion? I have one item for discussion. So, one thing I'd like, some of you will be here next year and years moving forward, and I'd like for you to take note of something. The total revenue calculation we have up here, this is produced by the addition of the amount we get from the student fee and the amount we get from the rollover. And then we call our total revenue. It's important for us to realize that not all of this revenue recurs every semester. The only portion that recurs every semester is this $742,500. And it's important to realize that in the future, we're currently burning through this budget, right? Even if we spend only $800,000, we're still spending, you know, over $50,000 more than we take in. And that means that rollover will start to get smaller and smaller. And as the number of student organizations increases and the number of students on campus increases, that money is going to become more and more scarce. And that means that USC is going to have to take measures to ensure that the amount of money we allocate is allocated more efficiently because we won't have as much anymore. We won't be able to, you know, throw it around like we do right now and like we have in years past. I think my freshman year, the budget allocations for the two semesters were $1.2 and $1.3 million just for funding board, respectively. And that spending, Mr. Baxter, is why we projected ourselves to be in a deficit, because the spending that was undertaken during that year was far more than the $742,000 we take in. That 1.3 number is closer to, you know, twice what our recurring revenue is. So in the future, I encourage those of you that are here to keep an eye out for that rollover, because it won't always be here. With this projected budget, as you just saw, the projected rollover for next year is $156,000, which is much smaller than the $447,000 we have now. Granted, we never spend the full $1 million, so we'll likely have more than that. But we are, in my opinion, we're tiptoeing a line that I would rather not tiptoe. I'll give it. Senator B. Grove.
How did that happen?
Do you want to answer?
Like, how did, like, the rollover happen?
How did we start spending a lot more?
So you...
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess, like, from what I know is that there was a point when our rollover was so high, it was almost, I think, like, two years ago, our rollover was almost, like, $900,000. It was over $1 million, so that's $1 million worth of, like, things that we weren't using. So we thought we could up the amounts of, so we offered, like, percentages for categories. We started just spending more in terms of, like, I know that a lot of us went on, like, giveaways, things like that. But then it got to the point where there were more student groups requesting money, and then there were more, we realized that we were at the point that if we continue to spend like this with the amount of students who are coming in, that we were expected to run it.
The rationale behind the accelerated spending rate was that we shouldn't have a rollover. If we had a rollover and we didn't spend all the money we took in, that meant that we didn't need that money. And I believe the intent behind that policy was to make sure that the Student Fee Advisory Committee didn't cut our fee allocation because we didn't want that to happen. So we began to, like Comptroller Sadani said, increase rates of funding, increase caps. Last year, the cap was not $10,000 but $12,000. Category B or capital requests were not funded at 90% but 100%. And things of that nature occur. Additionally, we spent a lot more in our committees than we spent before. We accelerated spending because we wanted to use all the money that we had. But now we're entering, we finished that burn down phase, if you will. And we're going to be reaching the point very soon where we can't burn down anymore. I'll leave it. Are there any further questions? Senator Baxter.
So the spring 2017, when my first Senate with you guys the first semester, we were discussing at the end of the semester the possibility of reducing the club count. I don't think that will happen, but I was wondering if we would still do that, just because what if there's redundancies in the club count?
Point of information, what do you mean by club count? Like the number of clubs on campus?
Yeah, the number of club count, does that mean actually it was like 700 right now?
So that's illegal, because we can't we cannot abridge students' freedom to associate, and that's why student activities will continue to recognize clubs as they are formed. They do part of that. If you're trying to form a student government club on campus, student activities will tell you that there's another student government on campus and they're officially recognized student government, and so they do a little bit of that, but we can't actually limit the club count, nor is the club count in our control. The number of clubs is in student activities hands. And there's a set number of criteria that clubs have to meet before they can apply for university funding.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Senator Turk.
Also, I think to like bounce off of that, as I understand it, well, we can't control the number of clubs. We can do things, like you pointed out, that we funding our capital requests and things like that, we bump down from 100% to 90%. So we can control the amount of money we give out to each of these clubs in like a rationing sense, as it were. So we're not there's ways around this problem. I think what Speaker Toomey was just trying to get at is the idea that, look, the first step to solving problems is recognizing it's there, and he's just like airing this out so we all can keep on it.
Senator,
how much money per student do we get from FIBO for our organization, and do we get the most of every year?
$45. $45 per fee paying undergraduate student per semester. So $90 per student per year.
And we get the most out of all the charities.
The next closest is Subog, and I think they get 25.
They get like half of what
we get. We have twice the amount of money as the next highest tier three organization.
So with this current budget and the funding board's budget specifically, I'm going to ask you this, Tia, this could be a Richard, the chair of funding board's purview, but is this sustainable for funding board? Is there a possibility, any possibility of a change again in percentages? Or is this sustainable and is this going to probably continue to fall 2018?
What kind of information would you think might change in percentages?
Because last, as you experienced last semester, we had to completely revamp our funding policies and give everyone less. So I'm asking our comptroller if, with this $800,000 and how we expect to go in the future, is there any possibility of us having to change funding policies again, or is it going to be continued?
So I can't say for sure that the next administration will be working on policies. For now, I don't see any. The most changes we need, I sort of policies are a lot of the gray areas, so I guess like one big thing was like the 6-week deadline. There's a lot of gray area there, so more so improving our policies to make them more clear rather than changing.
Thank you. Thank you, Congressman. Is there any further discussion on the topic? Seeing none, we will move into a vote. This copy was amended. Let me make sure that the copy in the drive affects the first copy. All in favor of an act concerning the 2018 spring budget of the undergraduate student government, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please signify by saying nay. Any abstentions? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and the motion carries. I'd like to add an item to discussion by unanimous consent concerning the removal of members from the body via motion of consent or no confidence. That is the first item on discussion, seeing that it's the next. Or is there any objection? Seeing none, it is now the next item in the discussion. We'll move into that item. I'd like to take this off. So, as you saw today, we had a bit of an issue in quorum. There are some members of the body, as you, I'm sure you are aware, that either have class conflicts or do regularly not attend the Senate. Would you want to initiate a motion of no confidence either tonight or at the next Senate to ensure that we take quorum without issue? I'll use Senator Murray.
Sure. So first, can I ask a question of you? Have you contacted each of these senators who have been lacking in attendance and asked them if they plan to continue in the organization or resign?
I've contacted some of them. I have not contacted all of them. Yes, Senator Murray.
Then my stance would be that I would recommend that the chair send an official email to all of these people who are pending such a motion of no confidence, and then at next Senate, either accept resignations from those who choose to resign, or present to us your opinion on who has tendered an acceptable reasoning behind their absence and who should be removed.
Thank you, Senator Murray. I look quite like that. Senator Burr.
I second Senator Burr's concerns. The email sent from the speaker to all these people, I will be confident in voting for a vote of no confidence next Senate, but now I do not feel confident in voting these members off.
Thank you.
I yield my time to the chair.
Senator Wojcicki, and then Senator Wojcicki.
So I'm just curious as to how the process exactly would go.
The way I'd like to do it is bring forth motions of no confidence as main motions on the agenda for the next meeting. That gives them significant or sufficient time to respond to an email concerning their commitment to the Senate, and we can deal with this promptly as it'll be the next time we all meet.
Point of information.
Yes.
How does the removal process for senators work? I was under the impression that the chair, or in this case the speaker, would remove them and then bring it to the Senate, and the Senate had a chance to overturn that decision.
Yes.
You could elaborate.
Currently, there are only two members of Senate leadership, myself and Parliamentarian Jim, and I don't think that two people should be able to make a decision that strips someone of membership, which then has to be overturned by a motion of the Senate. It just doesn't seem right. So I'd rather bring it to the full Senate initially so that you all get say. You don't have to negate the decision. You get to make the decision.
Point of information.
Yes.
Is it a majority or a simple majority vote?
I believe it is a simple, but I can check up on that. Yes.
I was just going to say really quickly that I think it's a good idea to just send them one final email to say, listen, your attendance has been lacking. You have to either resign or get thrown out or whatever, show up. Just in that way, it won't be like, hey, I didn't get any notice, you know. Give them one notice and explicitly state, if you don't show up, you're going to get, you know, we're going to do a vote of confidence and you're going to be removed from the body. And that's the best kind of action. That way nobody can come out when you guys are saying, oh, you voted me out without any warning. You'll give it a fair warning and it'll be good to go.
Thank you, Senator. Senator McHugh. So the main metric I've been going off of is Senate attendance, because that's what we most directly feel with quorum. But we can check to make sure that these people have, you know, attended their office hours or their committee. If you want, Senator Baxter,
did we pass that legislation last semester saying if you miss two Senates and if you miss two meetings, that is grounds for removal? Or was that something that was brought up but we just never did pass?
That was brought up and we did not pass.
Okay. And then my second question is, out of all the people who are missing tonight, did any of them say that they couldn't come?
Yes. Everyone who you see here marked with an E was either ill or, yes, they had an excuse.
Okay.
Mr. Speaker, would you find it reasonable for the Senate body to ask you send these emails before the start of next week, so that gives an ample time?
Oh, of course. Yes. I plan to send them during business tomorrow.
Okay. Just a follow-up question. Would we have to, because I want to put that formally so we have something saying that you will, so how would that be done? How would it be us asking, or? I'm trying to put a time frame for you, for the Senate body, to tell the Speaker to send me the email. I just don't want it to be based on your word. No offense to you, Speaker, at all, but I just want it to be writing somewhere in our minutes that we designated a time period so they feel like it's reasonable.
We currently moved out of new business so we could go back, but frankly, don't think that that's super necessary. Everything is on the minutes already. If you haven't been here for any Senate meetings, you know that. And I do have a list of these people, and the email is written, it's just not sent.
Thank you.
further points on motion.
So if these people are resigned from their office because of the role of no confidence, that means these Senate seats are open, correct?
Yes.
And will they stay open the remainder of the semester, or will there be a chance for people to fill them?
Yes, there's currently no plans in place for a special election.
Point of information, would it not be true that these seats would be open for the spring election? Or removed prior to?
Potentially. One issue that we have is that the solicitation process for signatures and for the intent to run forms has already passed. So the likelihood that these positions will be on the spring 2018 ballot is not high. Senator Wojcicki.
I was like to answer your question as well before by Senator Rucco. It is two-thirds majority.
Two-thirds majority.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any further points or motions on the floor? Any discussion on the floor? Seeing none, can I have a motion to adjourn? Announcements. Are there any announcements? I have one from Chairperson Foley. She has these hats here, these USG beanies. They're $15. If you want one, you can come up and get it. Just Venmo Baloo $15. Senator Wojcicki.
Cupcakes. I brought cupcakes, sir. Well, they're sitting over there.
Love you too, Josh.
Is there a motion? Are there any announcement items? Senator Perl.
So I've been talking a lot about this. I've been recently thinking of ways of trying to incentivize USGs to try to keep our membership. Today we saw we had a problem getting quorum. Next week we're going to be doing votes of no confidence. So I would like to work with as many people as possible in trying to think of ways of do that. I would like to wait until after the Constitution is approved, because I think this is more of a bylaw issue. But again, it's something we can talk about. Namely, I'm trying to make USG be an opportunity for credit. For me, just that makes a lot of sense. Whether it's an internship, a independent study, a community course, I don't know. These are things we've talked about with administrators. But that's just where I'm at right now, and I'll put the bug in your hands.
Thank you. Last time I talked to everybody, but an issue that I find personal and I think very important for the student body to address, and us especially, is the prevalence of bike racks on campus. I've been working on this. I've talked to maintenance, I've talked to facilities, I've talked to President Fuchs and Hertz about this, and they're all in agreement that there are efforts to try to make more bike racks on campus, especially in the residence halls. I'm going to be working on legislation. I think it's time we finally make a declaration. This has been in the works for months, so this isn't new. Anybody that wants to work with me, you want to find out information about the bike racks in your residence hall, give me that info. We can draft legislation that's specific, detail-oriented. And just email me, Speaker Tumu, and I have my email. Talk to me after Senate. I want to work on that, and we'll be seeing Senate on that to work with you all.
Are there any further announcements? Senator Reynolds.
With permission from the chair, I yield by board
that yield is granted.
What's up, people? Yeah, I'm still here. I didn't leave you. Tomorrow, in case you haven't heard enough times, USG is sending people to the Capitol to testify to the Legislative Appropriations Committee about our budget. Our budget has been adjusted down according to Office of Policy and Management, which works with the governor's office, by a little bit over $5 million. This adjustment was expected, so UConn, the administration, has taken care to make sure that appropriate places have been adjusted down to compensate for this loss. That being said, we don't know what could happen in the second half of this biennium. We could lose more money, maybe we could get more money. We don't know. So what we need is for anybody that has time tomorrow, if you're interested, this is the last call. You guys have all gotten a bunch of emails from President Valverde about this. just fill out the Google form so that you can get a seat on the bus. We are trying to fill a bus. I don't know if a whole bus has been filled yet. Do any of you know how many? No? Okay, so we are trying to fill one bus. If you have the time, you can go, absolutely. We'll get back to stores at about 8:45. There will be pizza there. I'm going to be there all day from the independent study. But yeah, we would really appreciate it if you guys and your friends would go to this. So that's all I got. Now I'm going to go back to looking in the back of the room. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Room. Are there any further announcements? Seeing none, I'd like to adjourn at 8:09 p.m. by unanimous consent. Are there any objections?
No. Thank you.